talk to him. Ladies and gentlemen, the hearing will come to order. Today, the subcommittee will examine the military resale programs within the Department of Defense, specifically the commissaries and exchanges operated by the department. These programs are widely acknowledged as highly valuable and appreciated benefits that support active duty retention, the well-being of the military community, and the combat readiness of the force. These services are vital for our service members, military families, and veterans worldwide. In the current economy, commissaries and exchanges provide extraordinary job opportunities for military spouses and families. However, the recent pressures on the defense budget have yielded a number of initiatives to reduce funding for these programs and decrease their value to service members and their families. Although the threats to these programs were significant in 2011, the coordinated efforts of all of the members of the subcommittee, and in particular, the ranking member, Ms. Susan Davis, we were successful in fending off significant budget reductions. Unfortunately, we cannot declare victory in this battle, as the continuing pressure to shift budgets within the Department of Defense will energize the people who do not fully appreciate the value of these programs. This pressure can only be expected to increase in the coming months as the Congress debates the devastating reductions to defense accounts that are associated with the sequestration process scheduled to begin next year, which destroy jobs. Let me be clear, I remain a strong supporter of military commissaries and exchanges and will continue to work in a bipartisan manner to ensure these programs endure through this era of budget challenges and remain the effective benefits they have long served our men and women in uniform and the nation for so long. I'd like to introduce our witnesses, Mr. Robert L. Gordon. He's the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense, Military Community and Family Policy, Office of the Undersecretary of Defense for Personnel and Readiness. Thank you for joining us again. Brigadier General Francis L. Hendricks, Commander of the Army and Air Force Exchange Service. Rear Admiral Robert J. Bianchi, he is the retired Chief Executive Officer of the Navy Exchange Service Command. Mr. Joseph Jew, Director and Chief Executive Officer of the Defense Commissary Agency. Mr. William C. Dillon, Director, Semper Fit and Exchange Services, Manpower and Reserve Affairs Department, Headquarters of the U.S. Marine Corps. Mr. Patrick B. Nixon, President of the American Logistics Association. And Mr. Thomas T. Gordy, President of the Armed Forces Marketing Council. There are a number of familiar faces among the witnesses, Mr. Gordon, Mr. Jew, and Admiral Bianchi. Welcome back to all of you, especially you, Admiral Bianchi, as you begin your new life out of uniform as a civilian. And welcome back to our witnesses that bring us important perspective of the private sector, Pat Nixon and Tom Gordy. It is good to see all of you here today. General Hendricks, I understand you'll soon be retiring from the Air Force after 32 years plus of service. Please accept our gratitude for your service to our nation and our best wishes for your future. Mr. Dillon, not wanting to leave you out, welcome for the first time. I would also like to make note of the retirement last week of Ms. Janice White, the Director, Resale Activities and Non-Appropriated Fund Policy, after 34 years of service. Janice's expertise and wise counsel were highly appreciated by this subcommittee, and we wish her well in her future endeavors, which I understand will include considerable time on the golf course. And we do have one or two at Hilton Head that are available. Now I'd like to recognize the ranking member, Ms. Susan Davis, for her opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to join you in welcoming all of our witnesses, and you've certainly welcomed everybody and welcome those of you who are here wearing a different hat or no hat. Yeah. And I also certainly want to say that for General Hendricks, we wish you the best in your retirement after 30 years of tremendous service to our country. Thank you. Thank you very much. And Mr. Dillon, of course, welcome to the subcommittee. We're very happy to have you here as well. Thank you all for your service to our nation, and many thanks to your family as well. This is our annual meeting, as you know, on morale, welfare, and recreation programs, and we consider that these hearings are very important, and we know how critical the programs are to our families and the value that they hold for our military community. Over 10 years of conflict has placed a tremendous burden on those in uniform and also on their families and especially on their children. I always want to remember the impact that our conflicts and the wars that we have engaged in have been on the children of those serving in uniform. It's important in today's all-volunteer force that we ensure that the quality of life support that our families need, that our that they know where that support is, and that they know that it comes through many, many of these programs. As the budget climate begins to change, MWR programs will still be needed, and we're going to have to provide a wholesome quality of life for our armed forces personnel and their loved ones. These programs will need to ensure that they are spending limited resources efficiently. That's a requirement that we ask of them, that they're using those resources efficiently and effectively to ensure that both taxpayer and service member funds are being spent wisely. So during this hearing, we hope that the witnesses will share with us what efforts they are undertaking to ensure that these programs are effective at maximizing resources in support of military personnel and their families. I certainly look forward to that, to an open and frank discussion on these issues. The dedication and the commitment of MWR employees have displayed to our military families under very challenging conditions that we are really thankful for their contributions. You play a very important role in doing that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses.
Thank you very much, Ms. Davis. And we'll now proceed to the witnesses in the order as I indicated. Mr. Robert L. Gordon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. I'm delighted to appear before you today, and I appreciate this subcommittee's tradition of strong support for important benefits derived from our resale programs. Commissaries and exchanges are a highly valued non-pay compensation benefit for our service members and their families, and we appreciate that you also recognize their value. The Department's leadership remains committed to these important programs. Secretary Panetta has been clear that we want to maintain the quality of benefits that flow to our troops and their families. Also, our industry partners here today share our keen interest in preserving the valuable commissary and exchange benefit. Everywhere I go on my visits to military communities, I hear of the tremendous appreciation for, and in some cases, the need for commissaries and exchanges. Often, they are only the source of high-quality American-made products. But equally important, they are the lifeblood to many of our installation support programs. I also see how important it is to have these programs that are the number one employer of our military family members. In fact, DECA and the military exchanges are partners in the Military Spouse Employment Partnership, and each has committed to recruiting, hiring, and retaining military spouses as employees. Their jobs are listed on our newly redesigned web portal, where military spouses can easily apply for positions around the world as a relocating military spouse. My written testimony outlines our ongoing work in greater detail. Please be assured that as we continue to institute necessary changes, we will always consider these services as one of the most valuable non-pay benefits. We will do our very best to take care of our most valuable assets, our service members and their families. Thank you again for your support.
Thank you very much. And we now proceed to Brigadier General Francis L. Hendricks.
Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to address you today. AFES has proudly served America's Armed Forces for 117 years and remains focused on our longstanding mission to make the lives of soldiers and airmen better. A strong exchange benefit is one of the cornerstones of the military way of life. It enhances recruitment and retention, thereby aiding in the readiness of the armed forces. I want to thank the committee, and specifically Congressman Jones, for the language you included in last year's NDAA that authorized the exchanges to use the Federal Finance Bank. Your effort will result in an annual savings of $25 million. AFES is committed partner and teammate of the military resale community. Together with our sister exchanges and DECA, we're fully engaged in pursuing new opportunities for collaboration and efficiency for 2012 and beyond. Of course, we don't do this mission alone. I want to thank our vendor partners and military support organizations, especially the American Logistics Association and the Armed Forces Marketing Council. Our commitment to the military community extends beyond just the goods and services we provide. We've made a significant commitment to hiring members of the military community. 31% of our 43,000 associates are military spouses and family members. Veterans make up 13% of our workforce. We have partnered with the Wounded Warrior Project to recruit and train valuable associates. Finally, with the recent end of U.S. military operations in Iraq, it is worthwhile to reflect upon our efforts to serve those serving there. In the early spring of 2003, as U.S. ground forces fought their way up the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, AFES was with them. Our first store in Iraq operated out of the back of a Toyota Land Cruiser. As troops advanced northward, so did our store. From those humble beginnings, AFES support continued to grow, and at the height of the efforts in Southwest Asia, we operated 95 sites throughout the theater. During the next 8 years, more than 4,000 AFES associates volunteered and deployed to operate retail stores and food activities in support of the troops. We brought them familiar products and services and the food they craved. In that moment, at that place, we brought a little piece of home to them. We did that mission for 8 years in Iraq, and we continue to do it in Afghanistan today. Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, thank you again for your support. We are here to serve H2S. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. And I saw firsthand your service overseas and in theater, and I know how much the troops truly appreciated this service. Rear Admiral Robert J. Bianchi.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and distinguished members of this subcommittee, I'm pleased to appear before you today and privileged to be back at NEXCOM as the first civilian CEO, proud to once again lead this tremendous group of 14,000 dedicated professionals around the globe. Today, much is asked of our men and women in uniform, and in an environment of smaller budgets and fewer forces, more will be asked of them. Non-appropriated fund programs are an important factor in increasing retention, improving readiness, and sustaining the quality of life of our active duty military, reservists, guard, retirees, and their families. Navy exchanges, through savings at the cash register and funding for MWR programs, deliver more than a 6-to-1 payback of appropriated fund support, providing an effective and an efficient mechanism to deliver the benefit our military families want and value. Support to our military families is vital, and in these tough economic times, they expect more and rely on us more. Our 2011 annual market basket survey results show that customers save an average of 23% below commercial retail prices, not including sales tax, generating over $500 million in non-pay compensation. And for the second year in a row, our annual customer satisfaction index survey remained at an all-time high at 83, placing us in the top tier of industry retailers. New to the survey this year were questions to help us better understand how we connect with our military families. Customers responded very favorably that Navy exchanges make them feel connected to the Navy and demonstrate the Navy's commitment to their family needs. But NEXCOM delivers much more than savings. No commercial retailers have the depth and breadth of services that NEXCOM provides, nor do they go where we go, places like Djibouti, Africa, and Diego Garcia. We provide career opportunities for our military families and veterans. In fact, over 26% of our workforce are military family members. We bring a touch of America to sailors and their families around the world. With the support of our industry partners, we offer programs focused on military families, including customer appreciation events and joint events with the commissary and MWR. As a department of our base commands, we are also there during crises, as evidenced by our support to families during the earthquake and tsunami in Japan last year.
We're focused on supporting the Secretary of the Navy's 21st Century Sailor and Marine Initiative. Together with the other Navy departments, we will help sailors make good choices. We are and always will be a military organization that contributes to personal and family readiness. Because our sailors depend on us, we're working to deliver the benefits in the most efficient manner while remaining relevant for the future. Aligned with our industry partners and our sister resale agencies, we continue to work on taking costs out of the system, ensuring these valued non-pay benefits remain viable and strong for generations to come. What we accomplish cannot be done without the strong and unwavering support of this subcommittee. You have sent a clear message that these programs which support military families are critically important. We thank you and are grateful for your support. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. And it's particularly important, you indicated that 26% of your personnel are persons of military families. Thank you for bringing that point up. And we proceed now to Mr. Joseph Ju.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, members of subcommittee, it is my pleasure to provide the annual report on the state of the commissary benefit. As I visited many commissaries and conversed with our customers, I can assure you the commissary continues to be one of their most valued non-pay compensation benefits. At the same time, providing taxpayer an excellent return on investment. Few, if any other benefit systems, can boast a 2-for-1 investment return. Last fiscal year, the commissary provided direct savings to commissary customers of $2.8 billion for a taxpayer cost of $1.34 billion. The indirect support benefit, as outlined in my statement for the record, adds hundreds of million dollars more. Yet, some question whether today's commissary is antiquated. With 260,000 patrons visiting a commissary every day, buying $16 million in goods, there is no doubt commissary remains relevant and an invaluable element of the non-pay compensation package. We have much to be proud of this year. In particular, they include achieving an unqualified audit opinion of our financial statement for the 10th consecutive year, being recognized with the Secretary of Defense's Best Mid-Sized Component Award for employing individuals with targeted disabilities, and the Paralyzed Veterans of America Employable Award for expanding employment opportunities for veterans, and supporting socioeconomic programs, including $571 million in contracts with the small and disadvantaged businesses, and contracting for another $133 million going to Ability One program. In closing, I'd like to thank the members of this subcommittee for their continued support of the commissary benefit, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ju, and we now proceed to Mr. William Dillon.
Thank you. Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me here today to discuss our Marine Corps Exchange and resale programs. The Marine Corps Exchange is directly linked to our mission of taking care of our Marines, sailors, and their families, and it is an important part of the overall non-pay compensation package. Our operational success is measured on our ability to provide unparalleled customer service, premier facilities, and valued goods and services at a savings. We believe that keeping faith means ensuring that the exchange benefit on which families depend remains high in quality, relevant, and accessible. We are executing branding strategies, and our aggressive reinvestment into main stores has been greatly appreciated by our patrons. Over the past 8 months, I've attended grand openings at 29 Palms, Henderson Hall, Camp Lejeune, and Camp Pendleton. The new and refurbished main exchanges look great and offer a wide selection of right-priced, relevant merchandise in a shopper-friendly atmosphere. Our Marines' gratitude for being provided these premier facilities is evidenced by their positive comments and by the strong sales results since opening. I would also like to point out, in support of hiring vets, spouses, and family members, that about 29% of our retail employees our family members, and many others, our veterans. With our Marine Corps Exchange, Marines, sailors, and families can rely upon a high-quality product at a fair, competitive price and know that the proceeds are reinvested in their community, their exchange, and their MWR programs, creating a stronger Marine Corps. On behalf of Marine sailors, families, and Marine Corps Exchange employees, I would like to thank you for your recent letter commemorating the Marine Corps Exchange's 115th anniversary coming up on September 17th of this year. I appreciate the subcommittee's oversight and continued strong support of retail activities, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dillon. And we now proceed to Mr. Patrick Nixon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's once again an honor to appear before this subcommittee representing the membership and board of directors of the American Logistics Association. The ALA is over 90 years old, and its members consist of some of the largest consumer packaged goods companies, service providers, retail brokers, and distributors in the world. In addition, this year, I'm honored to represent the members and valued associates of the Coalition to Save Our Military Shopping Benefits. The members of the Coalition consist of many military patrons, resale employees, and thousands of Americans that care about how we take care of our military families. The valued associates of the Coalition include the National Military Family Association, the Fleet Reserve Association, the National Industries for the Blind, and our colleagues here today, the Armed Forces Marketing Council. They understand the importance of these benefits to the military and have stepped forward to add their voice to the discussion. I also want to take this opportunity to recognize the leadership of the chairman and the distinguished ranking member over the course of the last several years, in particular your support of these vital benefits we will discuss today. I want to specifically recognize the subcommittee for the construct and conduct of these hearings over the last several years. The transparency of strategy, discussions, and collaboration are a clear testament to the value of this unique public-private partnership that supports and delivers these key benefits to our military and their families. The ALA has undertaken an additional initiative this year by working with Secretary Gordon and the White House to harness the employment engine of the ALA member companies to support the initiative of hiring veterans and military family members outlined by the Joining Forces Initiative under the leadership of the First Lady. The ALA member companies committed to hiring of 25,000 veterans and military family members, which is 25% of the program goals. A point that also deserves recognition is the fact that the military resale system is the largest employer of military family members and veterans in America. Mr. Chairman, we have provided in our testimony for the record an outline of thoughts, concerns, and recommendations. During the past year, the CBO deficit reduction recommendation has served as the basis for several attacks on the resale system. We take great exception to their assumptions and findings and have included specific concerns about the CBO report in our prepared remarks. We are clearly approaching the perfect storm of budget impacts with extreme implications for every American. In any meaningful evaluation of the way ahead, there needs to be a review of all programs, but that review must take into account those programs that can serve as a benchmark for efficiency, effectiveness, and return on investment to the American taxpayer. The military resale system is just such a program. The savings delivered by the systems provide a 2-to-1 return to the taxpayer, and the benefits continually rank near the top of the valued benefits to the military. When you take into account the equity derived from the patrons' investment in infrastructure, the offsets to COLAs, the offset to military transportation costs, the employment opportunities provided to military family members, and the support provided to morale, welfare, and recreation programs, the economics are clear. These elements are captured in her formal testimony, and I'm sure will surface in our discussions today. Thank you, and I'm prepared to answer your questions as we proceed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nixon. And we now proceed to Mr. Thomas Gordy.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and members of the Personnel Subcommittee, thank you so much for allowing the Armed Forces Marketing Council to participate in today's hearing. I wanted to begin first by offering our most sincere appreciation to you, Mr. Chairman and Ms. Davis, for your leadership last year in getting 67 other members of Congress, as well as most of the members of this subcommittee, to sign a letter to the Secretary of Defense sharing this Congress's support for this very valuable benefit. We also are very grateful to Congress for passing the repeal of the 3% withholding requirement on government contracts last year. This subcommittee was instrumental in highlighting the adverse impact that the impending enactment of the withholding requirement would have on the commissaries and the exchanges.
Passage of the repeal has saved hundreds of thousands to millions of dollars from being unnecessarily spent by the resale systems, protected MWR dividends, and ensured the prices at the shelf remain low for the patron. The council would also like to go on record and thank the member associations of the Military Coalition and the National Military Veterans Alliance for their efforts last year in opposing S-277 and the Colburn Amendment to the 2012 National Defense Authorization Act, both of which call for consolidation of military resale as promoted and proposed by the Congressional Budget Office that Mr. Nixon spoke of earlier. Because of the combined efforts of so many individuals and organizations, we are happy to state that both pieces of legislation were not passed by the Senate. We also want to recognize the success of the Department of Defense and the military resale systems to continue to deliver a world-class benefit for military families. In my mind, one event occurred last year that completely demonstrates the importance of the benefit and the valuable partnership that makes it all work. When the earthquake and tsunami struck Japan in April of last year, military resale systems, working with industry partners and the services, ramped up efforts to ensure that military families stationed in Japan had access to food, water, milk, and other essential items like diapers and baby formula. And as a father of a 16-month-old, I couldn't imagine life without diapers, I tell you. The resale stores in Japan remained stocked while the stores outside the gate were empty. Not only did the system support our military families, but also was able to support the recovery effort with essential supplies, providing the United States with another element of humanitarian support to our friends in Japan. And it should also be noted, there were no price increases on the products at the shelf. There is a strong partnership between the Congress, the Department of Defense and the services, and the resale industry to ensure the effective, efficient, and continuous delivery of this very important quality of life benefit for our military families. There are, however, issues of concern to the council that we've highlighted in our written testimony and look forward to addressing those and other concerns in today's hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gordy. We'll now proceed into a round of members of the subcommittee asking questions. We're under a strict five-minute guideline, and we have a person above reproach who will be maintaining that time. Of course, that's Mike Higgins. And so as you see him grimace, that means the 5 minutes is up. But we'll begin with myself, and then we'll proceed with our other subcommittee members. As I indicated in my opening statement, I'm very, very concerned about the effect of sequestration, the defense cuts, as to the impact on our service members, military families, veterans. The defense budget has been cut $100 billion. It's been cut further by $487 billion. And now we're facing January 1, an across-the-board cut of nearly $600 billion. It's been interpreted it could be between 8 to 12% of the defense spending. And Mr. Ju, what would be the effect of such a cut on the Defense Commissary Agency of sequestration?
Sir, first, let me talk a little bit about the DACA. I think DACA has been model agency. DACA has been model agency for efficiency. Since DACA was created in 1991, we have achieved over $900 million in savings and reduced our FTE by 6,600 people. And so consequently, there is not very much left in terms of significant savings. So should there be any cuts, whether sequestration or in other means, it will have a direct impact on our service and benefit to our customers.
And I appreciate you raising this for the American people to know. And I'm just so hopeful that there can be a bipartisan addressing of this issue. General Hendricks, Admiral Bianchi, and Mr. Dillon, another issue would be appropriated funding. If that were eliminated, what would be the impact on your ability to provide services?
Sir, the limit of appropriated funding would hinder some of the ability of us to do that. Our main concern right now would be overseas utilities, which are now paid for through appropriated funding. We would either have to account for those on the business line, or they would come out of the MWR piece, which would be either way. It's going to end up hurting the family member and the soldier, airman, sailor, marine. So it would have a direct impact.
Sir, I would offer that from the APF side, one of the primary activities that are funded is second destination transportation. And so if there were any reductions there, those funds are certainly critical to us providing quality goods and services to our forward deployed service members to make sure they have access to comparable levels of service as their counterparts here in the U.S. So if there were any reduction, that would certainly potentially limit our ability to provide those services. And I guess I'm mostly concerned about places where there are limited options outside the gate, like Gitmo or in Djibouti. So there are certain locations in particular where, you know, no one has an opportunity for an alternative source of supply. So, yes, sir, there could clearly be an impact there.
Chairman Wilson, I would echo what the Admiral had to say in terms of the concern that I would have with second destination transportation not being supported. In addition to that, as you probably know, our facilities, our exchange facilities are supported. The maintenance on those facilities is covered by appropriated funds today on our installations. If those funds were to be depleted in any way, then over time our facilities would begin to deteriorate. We may not be able to maintain them for future Marines coming through the gate.
And thank you each, because you've really brought up real world circumstances of utilities, of transportation, of maintenance. And again, thank you. And Mr. Nixon and Mr. Gordy, what would you believe the private sector reaction to the sequestration cuts?
Well, Mr. Chairman, the impacts would be devastating. Clearly, we know that, and I commend your leadership recently in bringing the issue of sequestration to the forefront. It's an item we must discuss. We can no longer avoid, because action soon needs to be taken to address what's going to happen. The principal use of appropriated funds for the Defense Commissary Agency is employees, around 70%. The impact on the exchanges for the elimination of appropriations would just devastate their ability to provide any support for MWR. From our Save Our Benefit website, I have a quote. We asked for testimonials, and here's a quote I want to read. Kathleen in Ohio: "Our family is a proud military unit. We didn't enlist our family in the military to get rich. However, at times it seems to be a bit of a struggle to make ends meet. If Congress decides to eliminate our commissaries and exchange benefit, it will make it impossible to raise a healthy family, much less survive. Please do not end these benefits. We are a strong military family, but if faced with this, reenlistment is no longer an option." That's the impact on the military.
That's gruesome. And Mr. Gordy, very briefly.
Well, just to echo what's already been said, you know, the impact would be devastating. At the end of the day, what it means is that military families would not only have to earn this benefit, but then they would also have to pay for it. So therefore, there's no longer any benefit. And it would be hard to call it that going forward. As Mr. Jew pointed out, there's not a lot of fat to cut in their budget. And so the only way you can, if it comes down to a salami slicing of 8-12%, it's the military family who's going to end up feeling the pain once again.
And again, thank you very much. And we now proceed to Ms. Susan Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I think you've made the economic argument and certainly the support for our troops and for our families. I wonder, though, and I can assure you that we support you in that and certainly advocate in that way. Having said that, though, you've dealt with consolidation before, particularly General Hendricks and Mr. Bianchi, Mr. Dillon, in the exchange systems. And I'm wondering what kinds of preparation you've been under. Option 6, I think, you looked at in 11. What is it that you're doing to sort of help, I guess, to outline that preparation? And part of that, I think, is some of the advocacy that we can use to really paint a very clear picture for people of what this means. You've already stated that. I don't want to ask you to have to do that again. But you know, can you let us in on some of the specific plans that really help to address some of these issues, if in fact some of the concerns around consolidation were to move forward?
Well, let me start off very quickly that the department has no plans at this point to examine exchange consolidation. In the past, there have been 7 studies. Those studies have basically shown that consolidation of our exchanges actually can do more harm than good in terms of cost savings and innovation. And I'm happy to say, and I will let the commanders speak for themselves, that through partnership and through cooperative efforts, and we have many examples of those, that our 3 exchange systems are robust and vital as they currently stand.
I guess I would just offer a couple of specific examples where the exchange commanders are working together, as was kind of the outcome of the last study, which was the UETF, that consolidation really is the more efficient and effective means. At NEXCOM, we share facilities with AFIS for van stuffing to send products to Japan and Guam. The Marine Corps Exchange uses our distribution center. We support 120 Marine Corps locations through our distribution center. We just negotiated a contract for motor fuel in Hawaii. Between the exchange and NEX and AFIS, we're saving $3.7 million. We share a contract for inventory taking equipment that saved over $200,000. So there are opportunities out there. We have a very strong cooperative efforts board. We formally added Joe Ju of DECA to the organization this year. We also added the Coast Guard Exchange as an ad hoc member. We meet on a regular basis, and we have subgroups that are constantly looking for ways to save, to consolidate, and become more efficient. And those are just a few. I mean, we publish a report every year, submit it to the department of our efforts, and I think we've demonstrated over the years that we will turn every rock over and look for opportunities to consolidate and save.
Are there any areas that you've thought of in the past that for whatever reason have just been very difficult to do? I mean, what are the key obstacles as you try and look at some of those areas where you can be more effective? And obviously, you've been successful in doing that. I'm wondering, are there some areas, though, that are just really difficult, and is there any way in which we could be helpful in that way?
I'd like to address that to some extent, Congresswoman Davis. The services have cooperated on a number of areas. One of them that has been very successful in certain ways has been in private label sourcing of merchandise. The Exchange Select program in consumables has been extremely helpful for all of the exchanges. Wonderful product, as good as you can find. I know we have a Procter & Gamble representative here, but hey, our stuff is really good. But there are probably other areas, I think, that we could explore in private label that would generate some savings to a great extent that we need to pursue as an organization with the Cooperative Efforts Board that we probably haven't gone after as much as we should have.
Thank you. Did you want to?
Yes, ma'am. I was just going to say that, you know, since that last study, we have really, really embraced collaborative efforts in regards to communicating better with one another. Just the other day, I did an announcement that goes into all the commissaries and the exchanges over our radio system on the upcoming Army's birthday. I called my good friend Joe Ju and said, hey, here's what I just said. You just take my name out, put yours in, because our radio plays in the commissary and our stores. We're going to record him tomorrow, too. It's very important that the military community hears all of us and sees us all working together. So I'm very excited about where we're headed in our efforts, the new CEB, adding Joe and the others to the team this year. Communication's key as we move forward with the deficit reductions that are coming, that we're looking every way we can to assist the community.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. We now proceed to Congressman Alan West of Florida.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member, and thanks for the panel for being here, and Sir Rangers lead the way. As we just finished voting on the fiscal year 2013 MILCON appropriations last week, my first question is, Are we meeting your requirements, or what percentage are we meeting the requirements of the services you provide as far as military construction? I know we just talked about a new facility there, but are we keeping up with the demands that you all are placing?
Sir, I would say we have a very robust recapitalization plan. The Navy's formula is 70-30, so all the profits that I make, 70% go to MWR, 30% are retained for recapitalization. And our recapitalization budget averages between $30 to $50 million each year. In fact, we're just getting ready to cut the ribbon in the fall in Bethesda at the new, that's a new 150,000 square foot store. So we all realize, I think, that if we don't have fresh facilities, modern facilities, our patrons will vote with their feet, and they deserve a recapitalized infrastructure, and we're committed to doing that. And within Navy, at least, we have a strong board oversight, an MWR exchange board run by three stars across the department. And part of their job is to ensure that this recapitalization plan continues. So I believe we are meeting that need, and we do not have a backlog. We have a very structured approach to that, sir.
I'd also like to add to what the Admiral had to say. Our program, too, is very structured. We're doing very well. I addressed some of the most recent main exchanges that we've opened. We have a number of Marine marts that we'll be touching over the next few years. But I think to get to your point, sir, in terms of where MILCON can help out, with most of these exchange programs that we have in construction programs, there is a companion MILCON project. And it's very important that military construction funding be available. So when we start to talk about reductions in appropriated funds on the MILCON side, it can hurt our recapitalization of our NAF facilities if those companion projects that are required, putting in roads, putting in utilities, those kind of things, if the funding for those are not available. So in terms of being able to help us out, making sure that funding for MILCON is there, that we can get those companion projects finished and be sure that we can complete our NAF, our non-appropriated fund projects on time.
Okay. General?
I echo those comments exactly as Mr. Dillon said. That's going to be the short pole in the tent coming forward. Over the last 5 years in AFIS, we've done $1.5 billion in MILCON for the places we serve and whatnot. I would like to thank the committee for the assistance on lifestyle centers. Fort Bliss is just a win-win-win. Win for the soldiers and their families, win for the city of El Paso, the jobs. We collect appropriate taxes there from the concessionaires, and it's a win for the third-party tenants. Many are leading their particular industries locally, regionally, or nationally. Now, we have two more pilots coming up, one at Lewis McChord, which is presently 95% design. We look for a fall-winter, begin construction there of 2012, completed in the fall-winter timeframe of 2014. Very key for that big community up there. And the third pilot we have is at Joint Base San Antonio, which is presently 65% in design with a planned opening date of 2016. We appreciate, the committee's support there as we look at these type of things. And from those pilots, we will take things from there and spread them across through the other installations. But this has been a great program and a partnership with the public and the private venture.
Thank you. As we move on, talking about operations and combat theaters, and I will tell you that there was no greater day than when that first 5-ton truck rolled into Taji Air Base, and it had Pringles, potato chips, and cookies on it, and the battalion commander was the first one to get onto that truck. But the thing that I want to ask you is, now that we have ended those combat operations in Iraq, did we go back and do an after-action review to look at the things that we learned as far as, you know, that type of support of exchange and services? And what type of constraints did you see overall for your system operating in two combat theaters of operation in Iraq and Afghanistan? Any points on that?
Sir, yes, sir. We've done an extensive hot wash coming out of Iraq as we've swung from there into Afghanistan. A lot of lessons learned that we've taken back, and we will formalize for when we go forward. The biggest concern is when we started down this thing, folks in the building were looking around each other. It's been a while since we've done one of these, and so we had to learn on the fly. So we are capturing all those. We're using the lessons learned there. And again, we're already starting to, as we look at Afghanistan, our exit strategies, We've learned how to get things in there, whether they need to be there very quickly, various routes of entry through the locks, depending on what's available and what's not, and how do we take care of our soldiers there. We had a site last week that had a direct hit. We were able to get a TFE back in site, tactical field exchange, within a day. It's very important to us, to those soldiers, that they know that what they need, we can get there in a short order. And so, yes, sir, to answer your question, we've learned a lot. We're capturing that, and so that someday in the future, when we need that again, we'll be able to pull it off the shelf and be able to review it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. West. We now proceed to Congresswoman Madeline Bardayo of Guam.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and to all our witnesses, thank you for your testimonies this afternoon. My first question is for Mr. Gordon. As you are aware, I sponsored a Section 644 of the House-passed FY13 NDAA. It requires the Commissary and Exchange Oversight Boards to establish guidelines for identifying certain sustainable products. It also requires the Department to develop a plan on how it would implement greater procurement of sustainable products. I am very adamant that we can do much more to make the Commissary and Exchange system more sustainable. Private industries have taken the lead on these initiatives, but I fear the exchange in the commissary system is falling behind. So I would like to understand the department's position on this provision. What efforts, if any, are ongoing to procure these products? Mr. Nixon and also Mr. Gordy, I'm also interested in learning how the private sector can help to achieve whatever goals DOD may set, if my provision is included in the final bill.
Thanks very much for that, Congresswoman. Sustainability is very important. I'll let some of the exchanges speak for themselves in terms of what they are doing, but the Defense Department strives to be a very good steward of our environment, first of all. And in terms of the products that we sell and the goods and services that we provide our military community members, we believe that we are very thoughtful, first of all, in considering the sustainability efforts from the construction of our plant and equipment to our operations and maintenance to the types of foodstuffs and services that we provide in our commissaries and exchanges. And I would like to defer to our commanders to talk about some of that sustainability. Mm-hmm. Mr. Chu?
Obviously, we support sustainability. I'm going to focus a little bit on some of the sustainability that's going on in within commissary system, because we are the heavy user of energy. And in fact, our refrigeration system consumes so much of energy, it's quite important for us to be as energy efficient. And so over the last 10, 20 years, we made concerted effort to reduce our energy consumption. In fact, the results show that our energy consumption is about 30% less than commercial private sector. So we're very proud of achievement we have made. We have a great recycling program within our commissaries. We recycle over 53,000 tons of cardboard boxes. So those are some of the things that we do. And as far as product that we sell, there is no industry standard yet, because in grocery industry, that is still in development. As soon as we have more firm plan, then obviously that we will add more and more sustainable, environmentally friendly type of products.
Thank you. Anybody else want to comment?
Yes, ma'am. In reviewing the proposal that you have submitted, one of the things we did was reach out to our member companies. As a trade association, we have a lot of member companies that have some really leading edge technology in this area. And one of the things we thought is to put together an industry forum that focused specifically on this issue. Some of our member companies, like Wesco, deal in the construction and supply industry. The other consumer packaged goods companies have leading edge technology on what is the art of the possible in sustainability and developing sustainable products. So industry can play a very important role in working in the partnership with the resale commands to help to put together a solid program, ma'am.
Good. Thank you very much. I have a final question here for Mr. Gordon regarding container deposit programs. I want to understand how the exchanges and the commissaries in states or localities that have container deposit programs comply with these laws or those laws, or if they don't comply, what is the issue that hinders compliance? For example, I believe that military installations in the state of California and the state of Hawaii comply with the container deposit programs. So how is this achieved, and how can we ensure that we get compliance on Guam as well?
Well, we can. We have to understand, especially in places like Guam, what some of the issues are with respect to container deposit programs. I will tell you that we're working hard. I know that you want us to submit a report on that. We look forward to submitting that report, but I just want to let you know that the department is committed.
Very good. And I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Barjayo. And we now will proceed to Congressman Austin Scott of Georgia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll try to be brief. But, Mr. Gordon, are you operating under the assumption that sequestration happens?
We are not. We are not planning for sequestration at this time, Congressman.
With all due respect, and I didn't vote for it, but if you're not planning for it at this time and the president hasn't said he's not going to undo it, when do you intend to start planning for it?
Well, at this point in time, as Chairman Wilson said, this department is looking at a $487 billion cut over the next 10 years. And with sequestration, with an additional $500 billion, that would be nearly $1 trillion and would be devastating for the department. We are moving forward with our current plans in terms of that $487 billion over 10 years.
Mr. Gordon, I agree with you on the devastating cuts, but the fact of the matter is sequestration is the law of the land. And it concerns me when members of the department in leadership positions come before us and say that they are operating under the assumption that it's not going to happen. And I would just tell you that I think, with due respect, that as long as it's the law of the land, and as long as there are no plans from the executive branch, the president, or and it seems from Secretary Panetta that he expects sequestration, or certainly some form of it to happen. How could the department possibly carry out sequestration without having a devastating impact, especially to those men and women who are in the war zones, if here in mid-June you're not even, and I'm not talking about you in particular, but the leadership of the department is not even making plans to deal with what the current law of the country is. And I think that the impact on our soldiers from not having a plan is going to be devastating. And I think if you had a plan and showed America the end result of the plan, then we, those of us who want to undo it, would get a lot further with getting it undone. And so I would just encourage you to put together the plan, all of you. I mean, General, you didn't get to be a general without following a plan. And I mean that very respectfully. We can't assume that this is not going to happen. We cannot make the assumption that sequestration is not going to happen. And I encourage you to put together a plan so that the American public can see what the impact to its soldiers will be. And then I think that we will have the help that we need, those of us who want to undo sequestration. Thank you, and I yield the remainder of my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Scott. And I appreciate, in particular, Congressman Scott being here. He is undergoing a high element of flu, but that doesn't stop him from getting around. And so, hey. He has assured me that it's not contagious to Congressman West, okay? So, but hey, he's immune. Hey, but we just appreciate your dedication. And I, on behalf of the subcommittee, I'd like to thank all of you for being here today, your commitment to our service members, and it's so exciting to me to hear of what Pat mentioned about military families and employment opportunities. This is just extraordinary, and for our veterans, too. And so if there's no further business, we shall be adjourned.
Chairman.
Good job, eh?
I'm not very good.
Another one in the books.
Let's go home and do it as sequestration.
So first question kind of threw me off the loop.
I don't know why he came to you first when I'm doing this.